We'll complete the portions that we had halfway discussed last time, and then we'll discuss about the computer buses. And as we'll see, that computer buses are also an important factor determining the performance of a computer. We'll see what are the techniques that are being used as far as computer buses are concerned. So let's continue from what we were discussing last time. We were looking at the multi-core architectures, and we had said that when we have multiple cores packaged in the single semiconductor chip, the performance of individual cores are lower, definitely. We're trying to compare them with an ox and chicken, right? So let's see further on that. Let's basically recapture little bit, not fully what we're doing. We'll not review that. We'll just little bit recapture what we were discussing last time. So we're saying that even in the single cores, execution of threads and even a single thread is considered important. So it uses all those techniques we had discussed, out of order execution, speculation and things like that. And we are saying that one of the major drivers behind the multi-core architecture is the power consumption. And we had seen that the power density has reached alarming proportions. And since each core is basically a simpler computer compared to a single processor, it uses a simpler pipeline, 14 pipeline stages, compared to the P4, which had 30 stages. And also to reduce wasted work and in turn the power, many transistors are invested in large branch predictors. So the branch predictors algorithms have become more sophisticated to reduce wastage due to mispredictions. And we were discussing yesterday about the alarming proportion of the processor power density. And we are saying that the power per unit area has already exceeded the hot plate with Pentium 2, and it has risen further on that, approaching the nuclear reactor. And then we were just reviewing the dual core architectures, which started with the Pentium D, which essentially was two Pentium 4 CPUs. So two CPUs packed, it was as simple as that, right? Individual caches and so on. Whereas the first generation dual core processor really started with the Core Duo. And we're saying that it is a derivative of the Pentium M. Pentium M was used for laptops. And then the second generation dual core multi-core architecture was the Core 2 Duo. And we had said that now Intel is using core processor rather than saying Pentium. And we were discussing about how the cores are placed, the backend bus inside which connects the core, right? This is the backend bus connects the core, and then the L2 cache which is shared. And we were saying that actually the Conroe processors have a 4 MB cache, but depending on the success in manufacturing, it's actually sold as a 2 MB E6300 or 6400 processor or a 4 MB cache. And there is a significant benefit as claimed by Intel, 40% lower power consumption. We had said that the Pentium D processor was some 100 odd watts, right? So 40% reduction in power consumption and at the same time 40% increase in performance. And then we are looking at the specification, the speeds, the clock rate is lower than the Pentium processors, and the instruction set as usual compatible with 86 and the MMX SSE instructions. And it is the core architecture compared to the NetBurst, which used to be the Pentium's architecture. And I had asked you to prepare a write-up on the core microarchitecture, and we are not able to discuss it. Just looked at some very basic things like that the instruction fusion, macro instruction fusion, is one of the main characteristic of the core microarchitecture. Basically, instructions, two instructions are combined into two micro instructions and two macro instructions combined into single instructions. Yes, please. Front side bus, we'll just look at that. We have some discussion coming on that about the backside bus and the front side bus in the Intel architecture. We will be discussing that to some extent. So this is the microarchitecture. And there is a shared bus, and there is a 10.4 gigabyte FSB which is connected to the L2 cache. We'll look at it with a, as some of you are already asking the question about the FSB and things like that. We'll see that this is one thing that is inherent. The FSB is inherent to all Intel architectures, in contrast to the AMD architecture. And we'll see that why FSB is a critical parameter in the processor performance. And then we were saying that there are two cores which are symmetric. Instructions are fetched, decoded, queued. And then as we were saying that there is a fusion of instructions here. After the they are converted into microcode, the instructions are fused wherever possible. I think they have 32 instances where two different types of instructions are fused. And then as usual, the retirement unit, which is also the reorder buffer, and then it is scheduled to different functional units. All these architectures you are familiar, you have seen it many times over. Then the cache is accessed, and similar is here. But just remember that some time back we were debating whether in a multiprocessor the caches should be shared among the different processors, or it should be individual caches for every processor. And we had said that L1 cache would be individual, there is no doubt about it. But what about the L2 cache? And then we had said that there are some advantages of having it individual L2 caches for different processors and then the shared caches. But let's see what is the Intel's logic. Intel says that sharing the L2 cache is the way to go, right? On the other hand, AMD, the caches, L2 caches are separate, whereas the L3 cache is shared, right? So here the idea is that if different cores require different amounts of data, then they can dynamically be adjusted rather than increasing the cache miss for some processor. So the shared cache adapts to the mismatched loads. Independent cache can thrust heavy on applications when other cache is underutilized. Says that if one processor doesn't need much data, it can be shared with the other core, and it can dynamically, the utilization of the cache by the two different cores can change dynamically. And the other thing is that what they argue, the second thing is that a single copy is necessary used by both the caches, whereas if you had independent cache, it will be not two different copies. So still we'll have to see the performance and implications, because these are two schools of thought, right? One is having independent L2 caches and the other is shared caches. Now let's review some of the processors, and then we'll look at the Intel processor in some more detail. And we'll first review the buses, because the buses are also important, and then we'll review all those things, the front side bus, FSB, and the backside bus, and so on. So this is IBM Power 5 computer processor, and here just see that there is a L3 cache, but the L3 cache here only the directory is resident on the processor. We were discussing about this approach sometime back. The L1, L2 caches are on the same die, whereas L3 cache is external, excepting for the directory and the control on the chip. And there are different functional units, the load store unit, and so on, instruction fetch unit. So, if we analyze the Power 5 processor, we will see that as in other processors, simultaneous multithreading is supported in a superscalar microarchitecture, and there are additional program counters, and there is a general purpose register and the floating point registers, all those renaming, etc. We had seen this same thing. The completion logic is replicated to track the different threads. There is a thread priority mechanism. Last time I think we were discussing why thread priority is necessary, isn't it? We are saying that the individual threads work slowly, right? Work at a lower speed because the resources are shared, right? So if we want some thread not to suffer because of this, you would have to give priority. And then the dynamic thread switching, which we had discussed, the same thing. And it runs one thread at any time. Just see here. And the Sun's Niagara, this is another example. So this Niagara is basically meant for server applications. And here, large number of threads are run as in any server. And when you run large number of threads, the cache would be insufficient, large number of misses will be there. And as in other multi-core processors, simple cores, low power for every core, and simpler design, lower design complexity, and can accommodate more cores, and it supports fine-grained multi-threading. So these are the different L2 caches. These are interconnected using a crossbar switch. And of course, we are saying that the coherency protocols become difficult when you don't have a bus architecture, right? So those who are interested can investigate how can cache coherency be supported when you have crossbar switches, right? We don't have a bus here, but a crossbar. And we are saying that buses are becoming more and more bottlenecks, and possibly this is the way to go in future, the crossbar. And we'll see that the AMD is already using a crossbar rather than a bus. So these are the server processors from Intel platform. From the Intel, we have the Xeon server processors, and for AMD, the equivalent processor is Opteron. So just see here that the memory controller hub, or MCH, which is connected to the dual core processors. We have the caches and the processors. The data is coming to the memory controller hub. The hub is basically, it connects three devices which are very fast in operation. One is the processor, the other is the memory, and the other is the AGP, which is the video, right? We'll see in more detail. So here everything passes through the FSB, right? We have not shown the FSB, we have just shown the controller hub, MCH. We'll show a more detailed diagram. The different cores, the data comes through the FSB into the MCH and then to the different devices, right? This is the north bridge, and we'll have a south bridge here. We'll show that. So this the Intel has been persisting with the 86 architecture. We know that due to compatibility, and the front side bus, as we are saying, it's used in all Intel processor over the years. Essentially, all CPU, memory, I/O, everything is on the FSB. So if your FSB is slow, even if you have fast processor, fast memory, you will have a slower performance. On the other hand, just look at the Opteron. So here, as you are saying that they use switches and things like that, there are independent connections between the processors. See here, even the processors, they share this bus. Of course, this is the backside bus, what we are showing, and the front side bus is not visible here. We'll show on a separate diagram. So just see here, the memory is connected, and just see here, the data is coming on the front side bus, all the data. Here they have different paths, right? So the bottleneck that is visible here in the Intel GN and the core processors, the GN and the core processors, is not there in the AMD. And this architecture, AMD calls it the direct connect architecture, DCA, and it eliminates the FSB bottleneck. So this is a four processor example. Again, with the four processor, the FSB becomes a bigger bottleneck, right? So this, the memory and the I/O, everything is connected here, but here they are direct connected switch. And the AMD processor and even the Intel, they support different power levels, right? So depending on how much computation goes in, they reduce the speed of the computer, the processor. So it is optimized power management. As we are saying, that power is becoming a bigger and bigger bottleneck as the speed increases. So all these things have to be done. So there are multiple performance states for power management, and you see here that the high power, the P0 state, it uses a 2.6 gigahertz clock rate, and in the P1 state, it reduces a lower clock rate. The P0 state uses 95 watts. The P1 state uses 80 watts. P2 state 66 watts. P3 states uses 2 gigahertz, 55 watts. P4 state uses 51 watts. And the P5 state, where the computation is low, it uses only 1 gigahertz and 34 watts, right? So they estimate that for average application, 75% of power saving, because not only the processor dissipation of power at the processor is a problem, but also just see that if you have many computers like our lab, hundreds of servers and desktops in a room, just see the load on the AC. So we'll look at the bus, but before that, let's summarize about the multiprocessors that we're discussing. So we're saying that multiprocessors have been the way to go for the last decade or so. The focus has been on thread and process level parallelism. And ILP in the 80s and the early 90s, lot of performance improvement came from ILP, and now the TLP, the thread level parallelism, is the one that is being more and more exploited. And we had seen that multiprocessors have progressed over the last 20 years, starting with Arden cards on a motherboard to chips, multiple chips on a motherboard, and now as multi-core processors. And we had looked at issues in multiprocessor, two important issues, cache coherency and synchronization. And we had said that these are very fundamental issues associated with any multiprocessor. And we had also said that these are two topics which, when you say that you have done an advanced course on architecture and so on, they will definitely ask you to test you that whether you have really understood little bit even. Then they will ask you that what is coherency, how coherency will occur, what are the resolution protocols, synchronization barrier, and so on. And then we had looked at the solution in two broad categories of solutions, the snooping and the directory based. The snooping is suitable for SMPs, symmetric multiprocessors, and also the shared memory ones, and whereas the directory based is for non-uniform memory access processors. And then we had looked at simultaneous multithreading. But let's look at the future trends that you will see in the couple of years. I think last class we were mentioning about online fault diagnosis and corrective actions, so that simultaneously and redundantly threaded processors. So if a processor is idle, we can let it do certain works, and even the ones that are critical, we can run them twice. It increases reliability with fault detection and correction. So most of the processor nowadays, if a memory bank doesn't work, the computer doesn't stop. You see the older computers, there is a problem with memory, it will immediately crash, right? But here it just detects that and works with lower memory. And also it can run multiple copies of the same program simultaneously and detect faults. Software pre-execution. So this is also in a year or two, these will become available. The idea here is that in many cases the data address is very hard to predict. We had seen that many addresses determined runtime, they are not fixed compile time. So the trend is that idle threads on the SMT are used for pre-execution and finding out the addresses and fetching and so on. And of course, another trend is the speculation, where more advanced techniques are being used for speculative execution. Now let's start with today's topic, that is the buses. So as we were remarking that buses are very crucial. Unless there is a matching performance by the buses and the I/O systems, even if you have good processor, good memory system and so on, the overall performance would be poor. And we will just discuss now about the techniques that have been used in the modern computers for increased performance, the buses and the peripheral devices. But as we will see that the I/O, there has been lot of advantages, but not really comparable to what has happened in the processor. Because you will see that in most of the universities and so on, CPU design issues is considered challenging. Many people do research in these areas, most of the research papers published, whereas buses and peripheral devices have lagged attention, mostly by vendors, manufacturers. They have carried out the development work, and it is rarely the focus of large research groups in academia and industry. Let's see the current state of what is happening in buses. We'll just have we'll spend only a couple of minutes to review some basic concepts, and then we will look at the current state of the buses. So the buses are essentially a shared communication link between the subsystems of a computer. By subsystems, we mean the processor, memory, and I/O devices. So it links all of this, and a bus is a shared medium in contrast to point-to-point interconnects or the switches. Now let's see what are the advantages of the buses compared to switches. First is it is low cost. A single set of wires are shared among multiple units compared to point-to-point interconnect. It becomes easy to add devices and peripherals to buses compared to switches. And also the buses have been standardized, as we will see the standard buses. Now let's see the disadvantages with the buses. as we have been discussing quite often, that bosses are turning out to be a bottleneck. When we have increased performance with the memory, the processor and so on, it slows down CPU access to memory and also limits the maximum rate of I/O throughput. Not only that, there are several other problems with buses. For example, we'll see that the bus length is restricted. We'll see that different types of bus has different length restrictions. But on a general understanding, why is the length restricted for buses? Anybody would like to answer this question? That why is there a length restriction on buses? Yeah. So one of the main problem we'll see, the synchronous buses, where if the bus length increases to a meter, the kind of clock skew that would come up, you can make a calculation that what would be the skew considering that the electric wave similar to any electromagnetic wave, right? The speed of electromagnetic waves is known, even though this is a guided media, we have lower speed, but still let's assume that speed and just see in 1 meter what would be the clock skew that would be introduced, right? And you know that nowadays the transfer speed is really fast, right? So then assuming a certain transfer speed, let's say 1 gigabyte, we'll just do it as a homework. Assume that the transfer speed is 1 gigabits, let me just say simplify gigabits, and what would be the length restriction on the bus at 1 gigabit transmission? Just compute that. And not only that, the bus loading is basically every device that is connected sinks certain current, right? Every device sinks certain current, and that places a restriction on how many devices can be attached to a bus, right? And also the kind of bus protocol that is used will have overhead. See that this overhead is significant. Now let's look at some very basic concepts, as we are saying that we'll not spend much time, just couple of minutes reviewing some very basic bus concepts discussed in a first level course. So essentially there are three kinds of buses. The backplane buses used in older computers, which had a single bus connecting all units, that is the processor, memory, I/O devices and so on. Whereas the modern computers, there are two categories of buses. Any computer you examine, see that there are processor memory buses, which essentially connect a processor to the memory, and the I/O buses, which connect the I/O device to the processor memory bus. So in this arrangement, we have a memory bus and an I/O bus separately, okay? And here we have a I/O mapped I/O, which means that there is a separate I/O instruction in out on the CPU, and based on that, either it is output onto the memory or onto the I/O bus, right? This is archaic one, not being used. The one that is used is the memory mapped I/O, and there is a memory bus to which the peripheral devices are connected, and they act as if they are also memory addresses, right? So memory mapped I/O. The I/O mapped I/O has lost popularity. These are all first level courses, the contents of a first level course. The memory mapped I/O, these are read write to special memory addresses. Now let's spend a minute on the memory CPU bus, processor memory bus. The important characteristics of this bus is that it is a short bus. Why is that? Why is the processor memory bus is a short bus? That is because the transfer is at a very high rate, okay, and if the distance increases, there will be clock skew become appreciable to the rate of transfer, and it would not work. So these are very soft buses on a board, on a single board, and these are synchronous buses, high speed, and these are matched to the memory access. And normally these are not standard buses. The memory processor memory buses are normally proprietary buses, because you don't need to connect an external, you don't really hack a computer and try to add a new memory module and things like that. What is supported, you only give those, right? Unlike a I/O bus, where you connect different types of I/O devices yourself. Here, as a user, you don't really mess with the processor memory bus, right? You just leave it alone. The I/O buses, these are also called as the peripheral buses. These are longer buses, because the devices can be meters away. These are asynchronous buses, because the different devices are various speeds. There may be slow devices, fast devices, and so on, and by synchronous bus it would not be possible to connect so many types of devices. So here handshaking is used compared to a clock based transfer in a synchronous bus, and normally these follow a bus standard, because without a standard, how do you connect different types of devices, right? So all I/O buses are standard buses. If it is proprietary, you won't be able to use it for any practical application. In addition to those two buses, we also have a hybrid bus. A hybrid bus connects the different I/O buses to the processor memory bus. It's called also as a Mezzanine bus. A Mezzanine is basically a floor between, Mezzanine floor of a house is like a floor between the ground floor and the topmost floor. You have a Mezzanine floor. Similar is here, between the processor memory bus and the I/O bus, you have an intermediate bus. It's called as the Mezzanine bus. It's also a relatively short bus, synchronous. Example are PCI Express, PCI, etc. Now let's spend a minute on the synchronous bus. A synchronous bus uses a clock, as we had said. And here, all the requests and replies are sent only on the clock ticks. These are fast, because no overhead of synchronization between the sender and receiver, fast and cheap. No logic decisions to make about when to expect data and things like that. But one of the biggest problem of the synchronous bus is the clock skew problem, as you were saying. But as the bus length increases, it becomes unusable, right? You can't use at that rate. And also, everything on the bus must work at the same clock rate. That is a constraint, isn't it? Whether it is a processor, memory, the video, and so on, everything must work at the same rate. So if you have a faster device, it has to slow down, right, to the slowest one. The bus works at the rate of the slowest connected device. And typically the synchronous buses are the CPU memory buses. On the other hand, an asynchronous bus does not use a clock and uses handshake, like request and acknowledge messages. It's easier to accommodate a wide variety of devices, and higher length becomes possible, because you don't have to worry about clock skew. Of course, on the negative side, it will be slower than a synchronous bus, because handshaking involves overhead, and the typical asynchronous buses are used as I/O buses. Again, let's spend a minute or so on bus design decisions. Again, content of a first level course. The bus width is a parameter which determines the rate of the transfer. But we will see that for some reason, the bus width has become really low now. We have only serial buses, right? Can anybody predict why is that? Because bus width, we are saying here, is that faster, right? Parallel transfer is possible. But why is that we are having serial buses now? Most of the buses we will discuss, starting with PCI Express or USB or whatever, serial buses. Can anybody think of the reason? Not really. Any other answer? Exactly. So I think he seems to know the thing. He says that, see, if you have parallel lines, there is a voltage induced, and at higher rate it becomes unusable. And if you want to support higher rate of transfer, you will have to use a serial bus. That's the way you will see most of the buses we will discuss are serial buses, starting with PCI Express, USB and so on. And the can multiplex address and data lines to reduce the lines. The data width wider, faster, it's no more true. Narrower, cheaper, and also faster. We'll see that. The transfer size is multiple words and single word. And the master and slave arrangement between buses. Again, content of a first level course. Just to review it, I have put it here. We won't spend time here, just a minute. So normally work in a master-slave mode. The one that can initiate a transaction should become a master, right? The CPU is always a master. There can be other devices which can become master, and then the masters contend among themselves for the bus. The slave cannot initiate transfer, and it is activated by a master for a transaction. The single master buses are simple, but they are slower. On the other hand, the multiple bus masters, they contend for initiating a transaction and require an arbitration scheme. Various arbitration schemes exist. For example, bus request and bus grant, and you have a special arbitration unit which does the arbitration among the different simultaneous bus requests. You can have a simple arrangement like a serial arbitration, where some device, if it doesn't need the bus, then it will grant, right? So it depends, the priority of a device depends on how close it is, right, to the other master, right, to the bus, okay? So simple things, first level content, course content. So the master and slave are connected to all the bus lines, the control address and data lines. And normally a bus communication protocol will be used. We'll look at a couple of them. Specification of sequence. So a communication protocol basically specifies the sequence of events and timing requirements in transforming information on the bus. So this is a synchronous bus. The clock is present, and on the clock, the master puts the address here, and then the data is supplied by the device, and it sets up a read line, right? Sorry, we'll see that little bit. So it begins to read at the next clock, and once it completes reading, it sets up the wait line, right? And the wait is sensed, the completion of the reading is sensed by the other device all at the clock edges, and then the read is complete and the next read can occur. Is that okay? Simple one. There is a clock at which the transfer will occur. The master, who is trying to read, places the address from which it wants to read, and the slave puts on the data based on the address and sets up the read line, right? And by looking at the read line, the master knows that the data is available, and then it has a wait line control which it sets up after the read is complete, and all occurring at the clock edges, right. On the other hand, in an asynchronous protocol, there are no clocks, right. So, here a write transaction, address and data are put, the master asserts the address and data lines, and then it sets up the read write request, and then there is a acknowledgement coming in, right, and there is a handshaking overhead, okay. Is that okay? Very simple one. On the other hand, a read transaction on a asynchronous bus, the master addresses, master asserts the address, and it gives the request, right, read or write request, and this is a read request. The read request is given, and the slave puts on the data, and there is a handshaking occurring here. And similarly, at the completion of the read, there is a handshaking. So, there is a 4-cycle handshake. So, those timing diagrams and things like that, those are again contents of a first level course, but I expect you to be familiar with that, right, at least the timing diagram for read and write in a synchronous and asynchronous bus. But most of the modern buses are split transaction buses. So, this is another level of complexity here. In a normal bus, a read request is sent to the memory, and the memory might take several cycles before it can start transmitting. And meanwhile, if there are other units trying to communicate using the bus, they will have to wait. Even though the bus is not being used, the memory is not ready with data yet, but until the reply comes back, no one can use the memory. The memory is held up to complete that request. On the other hand, in a split transaction bus, the bus is not held up by any transaction. Each transaction is split into a request part and a reply part. And once the request part is complete, other transactions can be taken up. So, there can be pending replies, and that is why it is called also as a pended bus or a split transaction bus. And it helps improve the bus throughput because you are reducing the idle time on the bus. But of course, the complexity here is that every request has to be matched with the corresponding reply. So, here the request and reply need to be tagged, and leads to higher throughput, but also leads to higher latency. What is the reason? Higher throughput and higher latency, how is it possible? Can anybody explain this? Not really. No, that is what he was telling. I said, no, that is not really the answer. The answer is that, see, you just give a request and then you leave the bus. Right, and again for the reply, a contention has to be made with the other devices to get the bus, right, arbitration mechanism and so on. So, it might have to wait, even the reply is complete, it will have to wait till it gets the bus, right. So, on the average, an average transaction will take more time here, but if you consider all the transactions together, a single transaction will take higher time, the higher latency. But if you consider all the transactions together, then you will see a lower latency and higher throughput. Same thing that used to happen in the threading example, right? We are saying that the individual threads are slow, but if you consider all the threads together, then they are fast. So, this is the split transaction bus example. If you observe the bus, you will see that the address lines, the address is going one after other, and then the data is getting transmitted one after the other, and we have to match which data is with respect to which address. Now let's look at the bus standards. The bus standards are important as we are discussing, because the devices are manufactured by various vendors. And as a user, you are free to take device from any vendor, and unless the different vendors and also your computer follow some standard, it will become impossible to connect those devices to your computer, right? So in the older computers, we had the IDE and the ATA and the SCSI standards for storage devices. A little bit look at this, and then the PCI for connecting main memory to peripheral devices, we are just looking at that. Now let's first look at the SCSI, the small computer system interface. A synchronous bus, not used anymore, clock rate 5 megahertz to 10 megahertz, historically very important bus, the SCSI bus. It can also be configured to work in the asynchronous mode, but at a lower speed. Width is 8 bits and up to n minus 1 devices can communicate on the bus, 50 to 68 pin connectors. And though SCSI has a superior performance compared to the ATA and the IDE, but rarely SCSI is used. What's the reason? Because of higher cost. Why higher cost? Because historically these are used at much more installations, and if something is used in many installations, cost decreases, right? Now let's look at again the older buses, the ATA and the ID. Stands for AT attachment, and was developed in long time back as an attachment to the IBM PC80. I don't think that any of you have seen or used a PC80, 1980s. The PC80 computer was used, and it was developed as an attachment to the IBM computer to connect the IO devices. And ID is the trade name for the ATA bus for the products developed by the Western Digital, but it again became a standard. And there are several versions of the ATA bus that have come up over the years, UDMA or the Ultra DMA and so on, we'll look at that. It uses a 40 pin connector attached to a 40 wire flat flexible cable. Many of you would have seen this in slightly dated computers. The Ultra IDE is known as the UDMA bus. It's the 80 wire version. The ID, just see that the number of wires are double than the IDE bus. The reason is that the designer of this bus, they thought that the way to provide faster transmission was to provide a ground wire for each signal wire, so that the electromagnetic induction can be reduced among wires. You know, if you have the ground wire for each signal wire, the signals would cancel out, right? That was the idea. And it achieves a 66 megabytes per second transmission speed. But even though we say that it is 66 megabytes per second, the practical is less than 50 Mbps. The main reason is the bus congestion and the protocol overhead. But the speed is quite all right. 50 megabytes per second is not a small speed. It's quite fast. Should be sufficient for most applications. But only when there is a transfer at the burst mode. You know that as far as the IO devices are concerned, possibly the fastest rate of transfer is generated by the disk, the hard disk, right? And as we will see little bit, if possible, that the hard disks have become smarter nowadays, and they use a cache and store data beforehand. And if the data is available in the disk cache, then the transfer will occur at a burst mode, and that might exceed 50 Mbps. The burst mode transfer can be become a bottleneck. Otherwise, 50 Mbps is good speed, even at the current computer levels. So we'll just take a short break now, and we'll come and look at the modern buses. What we have been looking at it is the buses used in the older computers, ATA, IDE, UDMA, and things like that. We'll look at the SATA bus and the serial buses. Okay, we'll stop now.